Your conversation is now being recorded for posterity. He's like, I don't like living in a society where everything I do is recorded. Yeah, welcome to the new world. Yeah, no kidding. Yeah, this is for the one at-home student who is in the 11th grade. We're recording this. And for, what's that? Yeah, it is. Yeah, Adrian. This is the only one online for the 11th grade. And the numbers have actually gone down in the other classes, too. But other people who are not present with us have the opportunity of, and the requirement, frankly, of coming in. Now, apparently, I've got accurate information that we're not going to get the last two. But they're going to need to, and I hope they hear these words, they're going to need to actually, like, watch and take notes on this, because, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, have attention, please, all quiet, please, go ahead and take your notes out. We are going to continue with Hitler. Yeah, Hitler, Hitler, Hitler. Whew, what? I know, it's good. I know. He's an important person in the 20th century. Well, then you learn. Some people have been able to get the same information by putting it at 1.5. Other people insist you can get it at 2. Laurence Olivier, I'm sure, sounds like a lot, you know, less sort of like British stage actor when you hear him like, little. Anyway, so good stuff. Good stuff. Already reminded, those of you guys, anybody here want to be reminded of like the week after break as far as meetings? Let me look here. I got Danton on the 24th. What time? Yeah, it's going to happen. Yeah, because it's really bad. Mr. Hansen doesn't like to be stood up. It's happened before. Yeah, he called and he's like, please hand the phone to Mr. Hansen. I need to apologize profusely. You can't see me right now, but I'm lying on the floor. Yeah. So yeah, and I've got Evan on the Friday after we get back. Most of you guys I've actually talked to, or I'm waiting for the revised Danton. Danton, I'm talking right now. I'm waiting for the revised version. And hopefully, like, the break is a real good opportunity to get that whipped up and to me so that then we can schedule a meeting, okay? Yes, you will hear reminders, and if as the numbers get smaller, I will be, like, hounding you, I guess, to get that to me, okay? Questions? All right. Let's go ahead and stand, do the pledge. Okay, ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, there we go. Okay, let's get right to it. Let's do it. We're gonna be continuing on looking at, we're looking at the years, between the time that Hitler came to power, 1933, to the time World War II begins in Europe, September 1st, 1939. And this is a continual movement of Hitler. I think he's pretty much got things in mind of sort of where he wants to go. He wants to make Germany big and powerful. And by goodness, he does have in mind to wage war. And so he's building up his military. We saw that last time. He's building up his military in clear violation of the terms of the Versailles Treaty, but all the time saying, it's for defensive purposes. Don't be afraid. Do not be concerned. When he moved troops into the Rhineland in clear violation of the Versailles Treaty, he said, don't be afraid. All other countries are able to move their troops within their own borders. It's only when they cross the borders and attack you that you should be concerned. Did the British and the French go along with that? Yeah, they did. I mean, they were like, the key thing here is, and we'll look at this, is like, make sure, write this down. If you want so hard not to go to war, you might think the best thing to do is to let the other side, potentially, that you might go to war with, have anything that they want. I mean, I child care analogy just comes to mind all the time. And you're like, some of you guys have had experiences as far as like babysitting or being responsible for children younger than you. If you ever get into parentage and so forth, you will face these issues. You will face them. You lay down a line, and you're like, wow, I just laid down a line. I guess that means that no one will ever break it. I mean, good grief, if you look at the history of religion, there's plenty of like omnipotent deities that lay down the line, and yet people break it. And that's like, well, what's going to happen? If you tell your child not to cross this line and they cross it, there's a test going on here. And how's it going to work out?
You're
going to
lose.
Who's going to lose? You're like, I don't want to have a fight with you. That's why you hear parents, have you ever heard parents and so forth say, pick your battles?
Yeah.
Right? It's like, and then they're kind of like, that's when you know, like, if a parent really knows sort of what they're doing, you know, at least a fair, decent amount of the time, they'll lay down a line, and it's not just a line. It's like a clear directive. There may be some movement in other areas, a little give and take and so forth, but when they put the line down, you're like, oh, that's a line. I'm not going to cross that, because if I cross that line, there's a battle. So what is the Versailles Treaty to Hitler? An opportunity to test the will of the British and the French and so forth. In fact, here's the cartoon. I've enlarged it here so you can see it even better. Appeasement. I don't know if you can quite see that word right there. It's basically spineless leaders of democracy. Hitler walking along their backs, getting his way, getting his way, getting his way. If we recall, if the British and the French, you know, you look back and like, if they had stopped him in 1936, the German military was smaller in 1936. He might not have gotten away with it if they'd sent the troops and so forth in there. But Hitler sized them up correctly. They didn't want to go to war. He was going to get away with it. He was going to get away with it. And he did. Just like he got away with so many other different things. There were some, and we'll actually hear from a man in Britain, a political leader, who sized up Hitler as a lying son of a gun. You cannot trust that guy. He is preparing for some serious smack, because if you look at, I mean, if you just look at the kind of government that he set up when he canceled democracy, canceled civil rights, canceled political parties, you know, and was putting pressure on, let me see, the Jews, basically saying, you're pretty much illegal. We're going to take you out of public life, kick you out of the public schools, make it illegal for you to interact and marry and so forth with other German people and so forth. Anybody know the name? I may have mentioned it to you before. The name of the British political leader who basically said, yeah, Hitler, you know, you're bad news. Winston Churchill, exactly. No. Winston Churchill, yeah. Winston Churchill is the one, and you're going to hear, shh, quite please. I've got a segment of a speech that he gives in 1934, early on, where he's critical of Hitler, basically telling the British people, look, I know you don't want to go to war, but the fact that you don't want to go to war is not good enough. You actually have to size up potential opponents, because those potential opponents, they want what they want. And they're going to push you left, right, and center, and they will ultimately go to war with you, even if you don't want to go to war. Churchill, in his speech, and speeches like that early in 1934, I mean, like within a year or so after Hitler comes to power, you can write that down. Winston Churchill was warning the British people, but he was being accused of being a warmonger. The British people liked political leaders like Neville Chamberlain. Nice guy. I mean, he's a nice guy. But Hitler sized him up correctly as being a bit of a pushover. He reflected British public opinion as wanting peace so much that he would be willing to see Hitler in the most positive terms. And that's how Hitler wanted to be seen, because it allowed Hitler to lay all these pieces together so that he could wage war at the latest possible stage and have the most possible success. And he almost got away with it. Almost. Neville Chamberlain. Do you see Neville Chamberlain there? Yeah, and he'll be the, write it down, Neville Chamberlain will be the British Prime Minister at the beginning of World War II. And that's when the British, shortly into waging that war, World War II, they're like, you know, I just don't know if Neville Chamberlain's the guy that's going to lead us in war. He was leading us in peace, and that didn't work out. So let me see, is there any British politician who might actually we trust to lead us in war? Winston Churchill. You can write that down. We'll see that officially when we get to World War II. Winston Churchill, a Conservative Party member, although he'd been in the Liberal Party, which is another party, and then there's the Labour Party, which is the more sort of left-wing, like, would be a roughly equivalent of the Democratic Party in the United States. During World War II, they're going to make a unified government. They'll basically say, let's not have elections right now. Let's focus on one thing, winning the war. And so they'll call upon Hitler to do that. But let's line up some of the additional things that will take place leading right up to the war itself. Okay? Let me see. Do we talk about how Hitler and Italy help in the Spanish Civil War, even though they're not supposed to? That's going to be nailed down very strongly when we get to... Yeah, we'll get to that in a big way, because I'll actually be able, when we do the Spanish Civil War, I'll be able to show you clear examples of how Hitler and Mussolini, Germany and Italy, helped one side defeat the others. And we've got a visual that you'll be able to look at and go, yeah, Picasso was portraying, right here in Guernica, portraying civilians getting the heck bombed out of them by German aircraft. That helps the folks that the Germans are, that Hitler is helping to win that war. Okay? Let me see. We got the militarization of the Rhineland, 1936. Did we do the Anschluss in Austria of March of 1938? I think we did. That was where Hitler looks at the map and he's like, hey, there's a whole bunch of German speakers in Austria, which is where he was from initially. He's like, hey, they should be able to have a vote to vote to join Germany. And they actually did set up a vote to join Germany. And Hitler, to make sure that that vote turned out just the right way, invaded the country. You did talk about that. Yeah, March 1938. And then they had the vote after that, of course. It really helps the outcome of the vote if you have German troops all over the place. And Austria voted to join Germany. And so Britain and France didn't do anything about that, even though it was like really fishy. Captain Von Trapp and his former nun wife, adopted mother to his children, marched over the Swiss border and then came to the United States and set up a ski lodge. And then they made Sound of Music based on that story. The next one is going to come. Now we've got this little area right here. It's very important. If you're looking at this map, you see the dark red. That's Germany. And this orange is part of Germany, but that's the Rhineland. That's where they were supposed to keep the troops at, but they didn't. And then you got Austria that was added to it. This is also part of Germany, East Prussia. Okay? This area right here, it's kind of confusing because this area right here is Czechoslovakia. Okay? The orange area is identified there. Write it down. It's called the Sudetenland. The Sudetenland. And it's in your handout on page one there. Right? We're still doing the third bullet point. What's so important about the Sudetenland? Well, as Hitler points out, most of the people living in that part of Czechoslovakia, kind of the border mountainous region between Germany and Czechoslovakia, they're German. They're German. And so Hitler's like, you know what? Those people should be able to vote to join Germany, to leave Czechoslovakia. Now, not them packing up their bags and leaving, but actually taking their land with them into Germany. You understand that? That's what Hitler's saying. Just wait for it. Let me tell the story, okay? That's what he's saying. He's saying, we have a righteous cause, self-determination. Germans should be able to be in countries that they want to be able to be in. Make sure you write this down. Czechoslovakia's like, no. That's our territory. By the way, there's Czechs living in that territory, too. It's not like there's 100% German. It's a mixture. But there's a fair number of Germans living in that territory. Czechoslovakia also realizes strategically it puts them in a bad position if they would have to give away the high ground, the high border ground, because it would make them more vulnerable if Germany ever decided, as they will, to just march on in. Here's Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia had a military alliance with Poland. You got two brand new countries, and they're kind of like, can we help each other out in case Germany gets a little too aggressive? I don't know. Maybe, but, I mean, they're next to each other, so that's not bad. But the real valued military ally of Czechoslovakia, they thought, was Britain and France. They thought Britain and France had their back. And Hitler was like, I don't know that they, Britain and France do have your back there, pal. Let's have a conference. Hitler initiated a conference. It's called the Munich Conference of September 1938. This is the last time that the British and the French are going to see Hitler as being somebody they can work with. Because he's going to work an agreement with them, and Hitler's ultimately going to violate it. The Munich Agreement. You can see the handshake here between Neville Chamberlain and Hitler, the British Prime Minister and the German Führer. The agreement to prevent war from taking place in the midst of these disputes is to give Hitler what he wants. Against the wishes of the Czech government. What does Hitler get? Hitler gets the guarantee that he can have all of this orange area, this Sudetenland, with lots of Germans living there, and the British and the French will not see that as a violation of their military alliance and so forth with Czechoslovakia. Yeah, exactly. And we're not going to do anything about it. And what is Neville Chamberlain think he gets? Thinks he gets? Peace in our time. Well, you know what? How much our time is going to consist of? Less than a year. Less than a year. Less than half a year. Less than half a year. That was an agreement in September of 38. March, write it down, March of 39. In March of 39, Dan, let's see if you can figure out what does Hitler do in March of 39 after having taken peacefully the Sudetenland? Exactly, to invade Czechoslovakia. He takes the rest of Czechoslovakia and sets up like a pro-German friendly government. March 39. Okay, so in March of 39, that's when the British and the French look and go, wow, what a lying son of a gun. We can't trust him anymore. Now, Hitler tries it one more time. He literally does try it one more time. He's like, oh, those German people in Poland, they should be able to be part of Germany. And Poland's like, really, Britain, France, you've got to have our backs here. Because, in fact, when Poland was created at the end of World War I, okay, they got back. It was created from German territory, Austrian territory, and Russian territory. And most of Poland is Polish people. So, I mean, it made sense. But look right up here. Danzig, the area right along the Baltic coast, including the very important port city of Danzig, is predominantly German. And Hitler's saying, wow, those German people really should be part of Germany. Well, there was a reason why Poland was created with Danzig included in it. Exactly. So they got to have a port into the Baltic Sea. Otherwise, they would be a landlocked country, which makes it a little bit harder to be successful. So Hitler's like, oh, they should have a vote. And, and Poland's like, no. And Britain and France are like, we got your back, Poland. Now, here's the reality. Militarily, did Britain and France then transfer massive soldiers and troops into Poland for their defense? No. Ultimately, when, write it down, September 1st, 1939, when Germany attacks Poland, is Britain and France going to be able to actually effectively defend Poland? No. Poland will be defeated in about a month's time. Germany will be at war with Britain and France, and Britain and France are like, wow, that part of the war didn't work out very well for us. We lost Poland. I wonder what's going to happen next. We'll see when we get into World War II, but it's not going to be pretty in those early stages. And one of those two countries, Britain and France, is going to be completely taken over in about a month's time in the following year, 1940. It's going to be France. He's got a plan. He's got like this and this and this and this. And he also, he's got all these kinds of things. And here's an interesting thing. You ready? Because when Hitler goes into Poland, he figures there's one other country that might really object to us going into Poland, because then that will bring us closer to it.
Russia.
Exactly, the Soviets.
No.
He makes a deal with Stalin. Write it down. This is in August of 1939. Sometimes it's referred to as the Soviet-German Pact. Literally, it's between Hitler and Stalin. A lot of times, though, you can see it listed right up there on the board. It's called the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact between the foreign ministers, signed by the foreign ministers of those two respective countries, Germany and the and Soviet Union. Guess which one Molotov is for? Nope. Nice guess. Ribbentrop is the German prime minister. And Molotov is the Soviet foreign minister. Okay. So here's the deal. Look at the map. It's an agreement between the Soviet Union and Germany that we're both going to invade Poland. Germany, you get the western half. Soviet Union, you get the eastern half.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, whoa.
I mean, it's Stalin. Stalin's like, I can't. First of all, he's like, I can't count on Britain and France to do anything. He's been watching what's been going on in Europe. He's like, those guys suck. I mean, I'm going to buy some time. Literally, he's like, I think later on that Germany will attack, Hitler will attack me. I mean, I've read the book. Somebody's advised me what's in the book. So I'm going to buy some time. How much time does he buy?
2 years.
2 years, yeah, because the Soviet Union will be attacked by Germany in 1941. Okay, that's going to be a huge component of World War II. And, yeah, when we get to that, we're like, was Stalin ready for it? No, he had heavy losses in the early stages of that fight. But he ultimately won because
winter.
He built winter and also he built a windmill. You're like, what are you talking about? George Orwell, Animal Farm. He built industrial capacity deep in the territory of the Soviet Union. And it will remain out of the control of German armies, even though German armies are going to go take all the area around Leningrad, go up to the boundary of Moscow, the capital city. Anyway, we'll get to all those details later on. Here's some other component parts, sad, because the Soviet Union is like, yeah, we're going to get our like Polish territory back, but you know what? We also want to get the territory back that was taken from us after World War I. Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. Write it down. Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, Soviet Union are going to invade as well, beginning in that September 1939 when World War II begins. And Germany's going to be cool with that. And other countries are going to, you're not supposed to do that. Is anyone going to lift a finger militarily to aid Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania?
Nope.
And they're going to fall. There was one other country, though, that had been part of Russia, and Stalin wanted it back, and he's like, we're going to take it. Look at it down. Write it down. Finland. And this actually is an interesting thing, because later, when we get to that, Hitler's going to look and go, wow, the Soviets, you really suck. You're attacking Finland, and you can't beat Finland? Wow. This is going to be easy when we attack you. Hitler was wrong about that, but here you go, the Finns. They will be able to defend themselves even under the attack of the Soviet Union. Anyway, so that's the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, August of 1939. When that came out, people are like, what? That's crazy. That's like Hitler and Stalin getting married. I mean, talk about extreme political ideologies. I don't know why Stalin ended up being the one in the bride outfit, maybe because the mustache is even more of a contrast. But anyway. I don't know, but Hitler is wearing the traditional bride-groom outfit, and Stalin's wearing... That's a cartoon, right? I mean, if you're walking around with that in Germany or the Soviet Union, you'd be in big trouble.
With that? I don't think so.
In Germany, the swastika is outlawed, you know.
Yeah,
but although it's like your intention is to mock the Nazis, so I don't know. You know, if they look just strictly at the intention of if you're using certain things, but whatever. I'm going to play some different things for you. Let me see. We got that lined up. Oh, and then, of course, September 1st, 1939, Germany attacks Poland, as is expected by the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union attacks the other countries, and World War II begins in Europe. Britain and France declare war on Germany, and you're like, now what? Can't trust Hitler. Should we have? No, you shouldn't have. What's that? Hitler and Stalin, it was just convenience. Very limited. Are you saying the United States had a bromance with Stalin when we were allied with them during World War II? Just a convenience. Just convenience. Yeah, we'll look at that one. I want to play for you guys, though, a couple things. Here is the movie tone. Here's the news reel that came out at the time that the Munich Agreement was made. One man saved us from the greatest war of all, says the news reels. That would be Chamberlain. Oh, my gosh. Well, it's news, and it's hopeful. They don't want there to be a war. They hope that this could be peace. Yay, peace.
This morning, I had another talk with the German Chancellor, Herr Hitler. And here is a paper which bears his name upon it.
Really, how significant is that paper? Don't do squat.
Some of you perhaps have already heard what it contains, and I would just like to read it to you. We, the German German Chancellor and the British Prime Minister, have had a firm meeting today and are agreed in recognizing that the question of Anglo-German relations is of the first importance for the two countries and for Europe. We regard the agreement signed last night and the Anglo-German naval agreement as symbolic of the desire of our two peoples never to go to war with one another again.
Yay, that's all you have to do. Sign an agreement. Hitler's like, we did it. All right, now listen to this one. This is very interesting, okay? This is Churchill, November. Make sure you write this in your notes. Winston Churchill, November of 1934. So this is within just about a year, a little bit more than a year of Hitler coming to power. So people could sort of size up, because there were news reporters and so forth identifying what was going on in Hitler's Germany. And Churchill was concerned. And he points out, you'll hear in the speech, there's different references and so forth, to lots of anti-war views in Britain. And, you know, like the stuff I showed you when we did World War I, I mean, visually, you look at that and you're like, man, I really don't want to have war. So that's fine if you don't want to have war. What do you need to do in order not to have war? How do you get peace? I mean, you guys are going to have to deal with this the rest of your lives. You live in the United States of America, one of the greatest powers in the world, right? Our country's decisions are very important that prevent war or lead to war. And sometimes they do both simultaneously. How do you know when you have to fight a war in order to maintain a better peace than a peace as in, well, we're at peace now because we just surrendered to the enemy. Wow, that's peace. Churchill is very critical of that. Put the context, though. Remember Churchill? He was a leading politician in World War I. He was in charge of the British Admiralty. He was one of the key people in charge of the failed Battle of Gallipoli. Remember that one? Where they tried to take Turkish territory. Didn't quite work out. They got the guys on the beaches, and that's about where they remained, where they were getting shot at, the Australians, the New Zealanders, and the British, and so forth. And he took a hit politically. He basically was forced to resign. He actually ended up in the military himself and went to the front lines, did Churchill. But he's in the so-called political wilderness. You can make a note of that. He's in the political wilderness like in the 1920s and in the early 1930s. So when he comes on and says this stuff, people are like, oh, yeah, Churchill, yeah, right. Yeah, you're the warmonger.
And you're a failure because
you failed the Gallipoli. Clear here. Listen to his words. This guy cares about words. Oh my gosh. He will spend hours coming up, crafting just the right words for his speeches, for the radio, or for parliamentary debates. Later he's going to be a very prolific author, writing about like the history of Britain, all kinds of stuff. I mean, the guy is just like crazy genius and stuff. But on the other slide, he also deals throughout his life serious issues of depression. I mean, he's got highs, he's got lows, he's got alcoholism that he has to deal with and so forth. But man, nevertheless, when you look at the whole scheme of it, it's like, let me see, how did he do leading Britain during World War II? Pretty darn good. He was able to hold on long enough to, until the Americans came in and took the brunt of the fight in the Pacific and as well as the as Europe. And he was, I mean, and he could give as good as he can get. I mean, if you insulted him, he would have an insult like snap right at you. One of the famous ones I remember hearing was a woman who was commenting on the fact that he was drunk. And he acknowledged that. And he said, yes, I am drunk now. In the morning, I will be sober. But tomorrow morning, you will wake up and you will still be ugly. Oh, 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 snap. Anyway, so that's Churchill. He's well worth the time checking it out. Listen to his speech here. It's a little bit long, so but try and pay as close and careful attention to it because it's very prophetic. One thing he actually does talk about is, you know, the next war is going to be really bad because one of the things I've noticed the Germans doing, they're building an air force. Yeah, and there's our great British Navy can't protect us against the German Air Force. And well, I mean, literally, it's prophetic. In my life, it's prophetic because he talks about how women and children are not safe against, like, a German Air Force. And I know that to be true because my mom and her sister were out in public with my mom's nephew in a carriage, and there was a German bombing raid. And they didn't have time to get to any shelter. And they were between two bombs. Yeah, you think so? Anyway, yeah, and they weren't even the initial target. It was like these were bombers, that the German bombers were on their way back to Germany after having been chased away from Liverpool. And my mom lived in the suburbs outside of Liverpool in northern England. Yeah, anyway, let's listen to Winston Churchill. He was a good communicator as well, just like Hitler was.
Many people think that the best way to escape war is to dwell upon its horror and to imprint them vividly upon the minds of the younger generation. They flaunt the grisly photographs before their eyes. They fill their ears with tales of carnage. They dilate upon the ineptitude of generals and admirals. They denounce the crime and insensate folly of human strife. Now, all this teaching ought to be very useful in preventing us from attacking or invading any other country, if anyone outside a madhouse wished to do so. But how would it help us if we were attacked or invaded ourselves? That is the question we have to ask. Would the invaders consent to visit Lord Beaverbrook's exhibition? Or listen to the impassioned appeals of Mr. Lloyd George? Would they agree to meet that famous South African, General Smuts, and have their inferiority complex removed in friendly, reasonable debate? I doubt it. I have borne responsibility for the safety of this country in grievous times. I gravely doubt it. But even if they did, I'm not so sure we should convince them and persuade them to go back quietly home. They might say, it seems to me, you are rich, we are poor. You seem well fed, we are hungry. You have been victorious, we have been defeated. You have valuable colonies, we have none. You have your navy, where is ours? You have had the past, let us have the future.
Wow.
Above all, I fear they would say, you are weak, and we are strong. After all, my friends, only a few hours away by air, there dwells a nation of nearly 70 million, of the most educated, industrious, scientific, disciplined people in the world, who are being taught from childhood to think of war as a glorious exercise, and death in battle as the noblest fate for man. There is a nation which has abandoned all its liberties in order to augment its collective strength. that country all pacifist speeches, all morbid war books are forbidden or suppressed, and their authors rigorously imprisoned. From their new table of commandments, they have omitted, "Thou shalt not kill." It is but 20 years since these neighbors of ours fought almost the whole world and almost defeated them. Now they are rearmed with the utmost speed, and ready to their hands is this new lamentable weapon of the air, against which our navy is no defense, and before which women and children, the weak and frail, the pacifist and the jingo, the warrior and the civilian, the frontline trenches and the cottage home, all lie in equal and impartial peril. Nay, worse still, for with the new weapon has come a new method, or rather has come back the most brutish method of ancient barbarism, namely the possibility of compelling the submission of races by terrorizing and torturing their civil population. And worst of all, the more civilized a country is, the larger and more splendid its cities, the more intricate the structure of its social and economic life, the more it is vulnerable, the more it is at the mercy of those who may make it their prey. At present we lie within a few minutes' striking distance of the French, Dutch, and Belgian coast, and within a few hours of the great aerodromes of Central Europe. We are even within cannon shot of the continent, so close as that. It is prudent, it is possible, however we might desire, to turn our backs upon Europe and ignore whatever may happen there. I hope, I pray, and on the whole, grasping the larger hope, I believe that no war will fall upon us. But if in the near future the great war of 1914 is resumed again in Europe, after the armistice, for that is what it may come to, under different conditions, no doubt, in differing combinations, no doubt, if that should happen, no one can tell where and how it would end, or whether, sooner or later, we should not be dragged into it, as the United States were dragged in, against their will, in 1917. Now these are facts. Ah, grim, indisputable facts. And in face of these facts, I ask again, what are we to do?
There's Hitler. Excuse me, there's Churchill with his warning about Hitler, saying he sized him up very well. I think it's very powerful that he says those words, very prophetic, and no surprise that the British are ultimately going to turn to Churchill as their leader. And, yeah, and Churchill's going to be trying real hard to, try and get who into the war? Us. yeah, especially, yeah. And his mom was American. So, anyway, we'll talk more about Churchill later on. One thing is interesting. Yeah, I'll show this. A little side, write this down. Sometimes people look back and they're like, oh, that Hitler had been a better artist with more success in his youth, that he could have gone into an art career instead of politics. Would have thanked, this is his art. It's pretty good. Yeah, I mean, it's pretty good. And so he would look and go, why didn't I get into an elite art school in Vienna? And he'd blame it on the Jews and everybody else, you know, because people were blaming things on Jews and so forth there. When he did come to power, he put his art sensibilities into official policy. He hated, write this down, he hated modern art. Cubism, there was an art movement called Dadaism, he hated Expressionism. These are some examples of what he would call degenerate. He'd call it Jewish art, although it's not all done by Jews. He hated it. He wanted the German people to know how bad it was. So he organized an art exhibit in 1937 called the Degenerate Art Exhibit so that everyone could see this stuff before he packed it away and people couldn't see it anymore because it's bad art. It was one of the most popular, well-attended art exhibits ever in the history of Germany, by the way. And it was very sad because some of the artists are like, wow, I'm being hated. They died. They were committing suicide. It was just horrible. What was his favorite art? Old classic nudes. like the old Greeks and Romans and so forth. But when you bring it in kind of a modern context and stick Aryans naked in 3D, it kind of looks almost sort of like, you know, it's got a little bit of a creep factor, but that was his preferred art, right? How would he have done on the IB exam if he had done, I don't know, would these pieces of art have given him a good score for IB art?
Yes.
Yeah, probably. Where would have been his weak spot? Maybe math. There is a film called The Downfall, which deals with Hitler, and it's German. And it's a favorite one because there's this one particular scene where he's in the bunker near the end of the war, and his generals are basically saying, yeah, the gig's up. These armies that you think exist, they don't exist anymore, and the Soviets are like within days of capturing everything, and you're going to end up killing yourself. So when he finally gets the message, he has a fit. And so these particular IB students made it as though he was getting his IB scores. And could he get the diploma? Well, no. Because he got a 1 in math, AHL. And you can't get a 1 in it. Nine, yeah, there's 9-0. So have fun with this. This is your life, July, after you graduate. I'm not worried. Fives. It's hilarious, that's why I share it with you. You got a 1 in your HL math exam. That prevents you from getting your diploma. Uh-oh. Yeah, it's called Downfall. It's a German movie about World War II. But since it's in German, people have done all these like mock-up things where they change the subtitles. Uh-oh. He's about to blow. Oh, that's Goebbels, by the way, on the left. Two years, I didn't get my diploma. I rescheduled the invasion of Poland so I had extra time to study. I conquered France in less time. It's logarithms. He does. Catapult for physics. Some of you guys are like, this is a little too close. Took me 6 months to grow. Stupid math test. That was accurately translated. Stalin. I wanted an education with a global perspective. Stab in the back. Yeah, I wonder where your exams will be sent. Burn them. FDR wasn't at the Munich conference, by the way, but whatever. I love this. He only read the Spark Notes. Oh, poor Hitler. He's not going to get the point. He might get certificates in some subjects, though. You can always get certificates. That's a fake class. I don't know. Hard class.
I don't think I could actually do WandaVision.
I have to do it. I struggle.
You guys can start wiping. Vitcha! Boom! That's it. There we go. All right. Yeah, that was a nice note to end on. Hitler has a conniption. I'm sure your experience is not going to be like Hitler's come July of 2022. Yeah.
We have a Math HL.
Are any of you guys doing Math HL?
I am.
You are?
I'm an
SL. Good for you. SL is, SL's crazy hard too.
No.
Those are, math ones are challenging. Okay, so you guys have a very enjoyable break. And as soon as you've wiped down, you can go. And don't burn all of your English papers yet. You can organize a big bonfire like one graduating class did. And they had a big, massive bonfire for all their IB papers and stuff. It was quite impressive. Yeah. There wasn't as many papers from my class. They had a fair number of notes, but most of the papers were from English and some of the other classes. What's that? There you go. Yeah, I know, exactly. Yeah, they're like, I mean, you could use them. In here? Oh, yeah. No, that's fine. Oh, yeah. Yeah, just make sure you get the details. Yeah. When you do your IB history exam, you just do drawings. And... All right, you too. Thank you.